Good evening, friends. It is my honor to be addressing such a gathering. We are all together in the midst of a very dark era. Let us make no mistake that India is going through a struggle that is equal to, if not higher, than the struggle that we had gone through before 1947. We tend to think that just because you do not see the physical manifestations of oppression, that it is not the same as, let us say, British imperialism. But this is more dangerous because this imperialism does not rest so much on bayonets, it rests on the capture of the mind. The capture of the mind, the hypnotic hold over the masses, the gross scale of lying, perfidy, and profiteering that marks the dirtiest regime that I have seen. Friends, I was a college and university level, if I may use the word, activist. I have faced the police, I have faced agitations, but at the first opportunity when I got into the IAS, I made a comment that now I'll be on the other side of the barricade. It has been a very interesting journey, but believe me, there are many in the civil services, many in the bureaucracy and other less understood professions who can remain high, who can keep their head high so that the flag of this nation keeps fluttering. Not everybody is a collaborator. In fact, most are not. You have to believe that. I am honored because of your numbers, because of your intention, because of your determination. We need people like you. India needs people like you in its dark hour during the fight that we are undergoing right now and the greater fight that we shall all have to undergo. Let us not minimize our task. On the very subject of today's seminar, for which I congratulate the AIBA and its regional unit, I extend my heartiest greetings to all of you, including your president and other office bearers, for the commendable task of getting together people in this difficult time. I think COVID has been of greater use to the ruling class than any other epidemic, any other historic incident. Now, we start with, let us say, Nirmala Sitharaman's address before Parliament, her budget speech, where she has come up finally by saying that two public sector banks and one general insurance company will be privatized this year. Well, more than half this year has gone. We haven't seen much activity. But I don't believe that this government believes is going back. Its capacity to strike at will, what it calls surgical strike, is infamous. Its capacity for hitting at the worst hour is quite well known. Now, among the two public sector banks that we are contemplating, she has not named them, but Niti Aayog has gone ahead and shortlisted six, as you know. The six are UCO Bank, IOB, Central Bank, Bank of Maharashtra, Punjab and Sindh Bank, and the Bank of India. So ever since Niti Aayog is like the Kotwal or the Daroga of those days, of the British days, whose very presence is ominous. Presence is ominous. It is packed with not civil servants. They are neither civil anymore, nor are the servants, but they are packed with some of the most determined collaborators of the darkest regime. They have announced that two of the six would be up for the chop, and there are guesses going on which two would be there. Some say the Bank of Maharashtra and the Central Bank, some say the Indian Overseas Bank. But in any case, if I go by the way these people think, they will put on the block something that is more lucrative to the private buyers. Frankly, after 40 years in the bureaucracy, I think the private buyer and the seller have know each other by now. Know each other. And we are going through the formality of a sale. But I think that the valuation of the bank, two banks that will be up for sale, should be around 50,000 crores. In that case, it makes it profitable. And right now, you can go back and calculate from the share prices of the of these banks, the share value, the capitalization of these banks, which two banks would yield you between 45,000 crores and 50,000 crores. Any case, there is no point in speculating. But I must mention to my colleagues, most of who are junior to me, I mean, younger than me, in Niti Aayog, that procedures have to be maintained even when you are collaborating. At the end of it, you are administrators. You will be called to question. You remain accountable. You remain accountable for the rest of your life long after this regime has gone. And this regime shall go. Mark my words, it shall go. I have seen so many regimes come and go that I'm convinced. Now, Niti Aayog has also submitted a list of 12 PSUs. And we are all talking in terms of this privatization of this year, the of 1,75,000 crores. We are talking of something like 70 to 90,000 crores under the private pipeline, as they call it, of resources, underutilized resources, etc. What do these amounts mean? A bank of a medium size being put up to sale would cost around 20,000 crores, would give the government around 20,000 crores. You can mark the figures when we come to it soon. Now, 20,000 crores is exactly the money that Mr. Narendra Modi is spending on his vanity. I'm using the term vanity, called the Central Vista. Most of you who reside outside Delhi would not even know the Central Vista, and you are not supposed to know. It's a fancy name for Rajpath and the surrounding area, on which, as you know, we have the Republic Day Parade. Such a low utilized space is being made through a renovation, which is nothing short of destruction of heritage property. But my point is, that the cost that they have indicated in the public domain is 20,000 crore. So in his convoluted line of thinking, his glory for maintaining his name on one single road and its adjoining area, 20,000 crores, is something for which he can sell a bank. Sell a bank. You have to look at it from his point of view. Now, with such a mentality, we face a wall of... difficulties. As you move along, this entire issue of why do you need public sector banks, we should come back to 1969 and look back. We means not only the bank employees. The bank employees must take a more active role in bringing forward these facts that you know, but not the public. I represent the public here, and for the benefit of the public, I would say that let us compare ourselves with 1969. I was around as a student, and I joined service within a few years. I have seen the whole process. In 2020, the number of bank branches we had was 1,61,000. And in 1969, we had 8,187. From 8,000 to 1,61,000, that is the number. The number means represents penetration. The number means service. The number means proximity to the citizen. And that penetration was done by a determined political setup. Are several determined political setups. Such a penetration would not be possible if it was left only to those who believed in profitability. Among these, the rural branches account for 53,000. That is my latest count, 53,000 against just 1,400 in 1969. Again, a very historic task has been done. And without these rural branches, hundreds of which we had to see in the districts and during our administrative career, the percentage is around 33% of India is covered today. Look at the stupendous numbers that we are talking about. Of the scheduled commercial banks today, the credit stands at 105 to 110 lakh crores. 105 to 110 lakh crores. That's a huge amount. That's a huge amount. And this outstanding credit, about 65%, two-thirds of this credit is given by public sector banks. This is the contribution. We can look at it from various other points of view. We can look in terms of employment. Why not employment? There is a bias against employment by a government that believes in flagrant support to capitalistic motives of jobless growth or low job growth or low cost job growth. Because without low cost jobs, the system, the capitalist system, would not flourish. And here, today, we find the banking sector contributing about 5.5 lakh to the employment of the country. Now, saying with all this, the charges against the banking system, for which privatization is deemed to be the magic wand, is that it is sick. Sick by what standard? Sick by whose standard? We have seen these bodies. We have seen when the public sector banks were taken up, when private banks were nationalized and given a public objective. I know what penetration they had in what we today call the priority sector, in what we call the lowest. It was enforced by the Reserve Bank's whip of those days. It started with 4% DRI. And the various measures taken to bring in financial inclusion. Financial inclusion and privatization are at loggerheads. They cannot coexist because financial inclusion includes a certain element of public good, whereas private banking excludes private good for private profit. These two cannot coexist, even with the whip of the government. So today, we are said that the banking sector is sick. Let us look at the figures that the RBI has given us. 55% of the total credit is given to big businesses, corporates as we call them. And 80% of this became NPA. Became NPA, I think, is one of the biggest rackets I've heard of. There are no other word that I can use because we have seen the sector at quite close levels. As soon as it's NPA, turned into NPA, thanks to strategies that all bankers know, at all levels to know. The favorite strategy, which we have not been able to check, is over-invoicing, as you know. The owner, whoever puts in whatever of his own fund, as his margin, as his stake, recovers it in the first few months through over-invoicing machinery, especially if it's imported machinery. So not only do we lose foreign exchange, we lose whatever contribution he had put up as his board money. So over-invoicing. Very soon, siphoning of funds starts, and then the so-called sickness begins. This sickness is a racket by itself. It's a game. On the one side, banks are losing their interest income. On the other side, the outstandings go up phenomenally. This leads to a case where NPAs have to be provided for. Now, look at the impact of NPAs. Senior officials of the bank employees would be knowing this. But for those who are not aware, 73% of the NPAs have been contributed by big corporate. I'm reading out from government statistics. The operative profit last year or this end of March this year, the operative profit of the commercial banks or the public sector banks was 1.75 lakh crores. 1.75 lakh crores. But this was wiped out and made into a negative means loss of 25,000 crores because 2 lakh crores had to be provided for as NPAs. 2 lakh crores. We have already provided for 6 lakh crores, and this is a cyclical way of putting it down. But what are the facts? What are the facts? The facts are that we are losing out through a steady siphoning of funds by various methods. One of them, as we have mentioned, is NPA and its coverage. The other is fraud. Bank frauds have increased by 3.5%, 3.5 times during the period of Mr. Narendra Modi. Between 2004 and 2019, the amount has gone up by 3.6 times than what we had for 5 years of the last regime. These figures speak for themselves. These figures speak for themselves. Now, what are the reasons for which we, the people of India, would insist on the retention of public sector banks? There are more than one reason, and I have already gone through some of them. I've already mentioned some of them. But in addition to that, there are several other reasons as well. Let us talk about Jan Dhan Yojana, the much trumped about Jan Dhan Yojana of linking the common man to the bank. While it is commendable from certain points of view, it is also a bureaucratic exercise, as we all know. But in any case, today we have 42 crore ordinary people linked with their Jan Dhan Yojana. Will these accounts survive privatization? Or is the promise a hollow one, like many of them? What about bank failures? From 1935 onwards, I'll drop 1935. There were 900 bank failures between 47 and 69, that is the private bank period after independence. 665 banks failed. 665 banks failed, and their depositors lost all their money. What happens after 1969, after nationalization? 36 banks have failed, but they were rescued by merging them into other government banks. This principle of merging failed banks with the public banks may not be supportable in all occasions, but if you look at it from the point of the consumer, the depositor, there is an escape mechanism. There is a safety mechanism. This safety net is about to be torn away, which means that depositors who have put their money outside the public sector banks would be at their mercy. And even those who have put it in the public sector banks are likely to lose a large part of their deposit even before privatization, because as you know, a new bill was sought to be introduced whereby the frauds committed by the corporate sector were to be compensated by the depositor and the customer. With a lot of hue and cry, this bill has been put back. So this is by and large a scenario that we have seen so far. We have seen how NPAs have been bleeding the banks. You see, if you talk about the new methods that have been brought about, the new insolvency bill, the insolvency mechanism, IBS mechanisms, we are seeing it now for 4 to 5 years without any success. They have brought in a new system called the NARCL, National Assets Reconstruction Corporation Limited, otherwise known as a bad bank. This bad bank is supposed to be acting like Neelkantha. You know, those who know Shiva know that his throat is blue because it's full of poison. these are supposed to be drinking the poison of the banks. In reality, they are aggregators for the next bunch of sale. And the assured price that they offer to the commercial bank is just 15%. At 15% of the value, they take over the NP of the bank, which means that the bank loses its power of getting back anything more than 15%. So the bank is stuck at 15% and it has to let go 85% of the property, 85% of the assets that it created. This is the concept of the bad bank that is coming up. Now the question is, why is it that this man is going around relentlessly? Friends, I'll talk political for a couple of minutes. You have to understand the strategy on which he has come and why such a strategy is inevitable for him. He belongs to a party, the main support base of which, an organization also, I'm talking about RSS. And those of you who are aware of the RSS, the Jan Sangh and the Bharatiya Janata Party, are aware that a large part of its support came from what we know called the small trader. And this small entrepreneur, the MSME sector. This was the largest support base. Mr. Modi's game plan is completely different. It's a corporate model. In 2019, a report was brought out by the Center for Media Studies, which I have repeated on the public platform many times, and many others have repeated it. If you get a time, go through the net, locate it. It's known as a CMS study, the Center for Media Studies, on the 2019 elections. Why I give credence to this report is not because it has gone into great mathematical work, great calculations, or great empirical proof. I give credence because it is headed by very, very sincere person. And the chairman of this unit is Dr. S.Y. Qureshi, the last really brave chief election commissioner we had, Dr. S.Y. Qureshi. And Qureshi has a sense of the field, and the calculation of this group is that 2019 elections, the expenditure was more than double of the 2014 elections, which itself was an all-time, all-world record. The 2014 elections is supposed to have cost the nation 25,000 crores, 25,000 crore, which is a lot of money. And this election has cost 60,000 crores. These are mind-boggling amounts. Out of 60,000 crores, as you know, demonetization was imposed just before it, so that the cash reserves of all his rivals was destroyed. Fair enough. In spite of that, people fought it out in an imperfect system. And the calculation of Dr. Qureshi's committee is that more than 45%, that is almost half of this 60,000 crores, was spent by the BJP. The BJP has neither denied it, nor attacked it, nor gotten for defamation. Defamation is, as you know, their favorite weapon. They have not gone in for that. So we assume that they don't want to get into an argument, because if you start pulling the worm, you might get a snake coming out. Even if you go by a reduced figure of something like 20,000 crores, this 20,000 crores cannot be contributed by 1,000 rupee notes. And this contribution comes mainly from big corporates and mainly from his home state of Gujarat, which incidentally has the largest number of fraudsters. I mean, there's nothing, no aspersion on Gujarati, but the fact is, if you go through the list, if you go through the willful defaulters list, if you go through the bank fraudsters list, you will find quite a lot of them from that. But he is not concentrating on the fraudsters. The fraudsters are for his fun. He is concentrating on two A's, A's and A. And they are the ones who openly provide for him. Now, if you take money from big corporates, they would want something in return. And the return is in the form of privatization. Privatization means to sell off my nation's property to you at a reduced cost. It is almost like the chowkidar of a guest house who starts selling the fan, the bed, the spoons, the cutlery, because he is chowkidar, but he mistakes himself to be the owner of the guest house, of the property. This is a problem. As I have told you in the beginning, I have seen so many regimes from 1975 come and go, and all of them flaunted their invincibility and their permanency. I have been threatened by so many of them that we shall show you. We shall show you. I am still there. You have gone well beyond the dark lines of history. So this regime will also go, but its model is that, as I told you, ignore the small businessman. What do you mean by that? You are not dependent on the two organizations that brought you. You don't need to depend on the RSS. You don't need to depend on the BJP. They, in turn, will have to depend on you for two things. Number one, winning the elections. Number two, financing the elections. Have you got it? You stand for winning the elections. You are the guarantee because you are the best speaker. And you also stand for supplying the funds for the election. So one has hijacked these corporate bodies, of the politically corporate bodies, for his own purpose, for his own longevity, for his own continuity, for his own continuity. In the meantime, why we need to bother about this game plan is that it is fraught with dangers, and we, innocent people, have been caught in his game plan. The banking sector's massacre is just one part of it through which he will recoup, or his friends will recoup, by taking possession of national assets, by destroying national perspectives, by focusing only on profits. His sector, his friends, will destroy a nation called India, but they will get enough surpluses to fund the next election. The people of India are not purchasable. As you have seen in the last elections of Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and Bengal. Bengal, that they have tom-tommed all around saying that it's a lost case. We have already won. The question is whether we win by 220 or whether we win by 230. People of India are fed up. Believe me, they are fed up. And the result was, let us say, when you look at Himachal Pradesh. There are newly enamored states, some states where there are certain amount of, let us say, understanding of reality has not reached that level where he will keep winning. There are certain states in some pockets. But where the majority of the states are concerned, majority of the people are concerned, there is a sense of disgust. His magic, his spellbound, was broken during COVID-2. You require what we call the tipping point, and the tipping point has happened. Otherwise, a state like Himachal, where nobody even talked about, was handed over on a platter to a party that is not very active. That is not very active. So with this analysis that I have placed before you, I would say that you can ask for a minute before I close. You can ask. Why is it that you are blaming only the corporates? I said I would blame only the corporates because after the assets are stripped, after the invoices are over-invoiced, after the properties are over-invoiced, after the company is made sick, after it is made to go through the death processes, I ask you, what happens to the man who siphoned it and built his property? Has any of them suffered? Has any of them suffered? They go to the next racket. They go to the next branch. They now go to the next bank where their mentors tell them, "Ki baat ho gayi." That's all. This is going far too long. In the process, we have brought in, as I said, the social objectives of penetration of rural areas, the coverage of my agriculture, the coverage of MSMEs, the coverage of education, health, whatever sectors you want, everything is now linked to credit, linked to the financial system. This entire body would be made to go to waste for the ambition, for the ruthlessness, and for the lack of morality of one man and his crony gang. Believe me, it is time for you, time for me, time for all of us to wake up to this challenge, not to make any pretenses that maybe things will improve. The things will not improve. I have seen before my own eyes how the insurance bill was passed in the last session. The insurance bill was passed, I think, in 13 minutes while people were protesting against it. I fear that the banking amendment bill would also be passed in this session. It will be brought in a hurry. It would not be in a democratic manner, not be announced to us a week before Parliament is opening. Nobody announces. It will be brought in a hurry. It will be brought in when people are busy with other matters and just slip through. This is my guess. I can't tell you anything more. I leave it on your organization to be mentally and physically prepared for this eventuality. Because this is the way the wind is blowing. This is the way things are going. With these words, let me conclude my part of the talk and wishing you all the best and all the strength to take on from your side, within your strength, within your limitations, a regime that India wishes it was never have come. See, thank you.